to Caribbean Insight. We have an explosion of Caribbean videos lined up for you. Tonight, you will be experiencing international artists displaying the cultural rhythms of soca, calypso, reggae, dancehall, and salsa. So relax, and let's take a ride down the Caribbean.
Man continue to shun his responsibility, creating free children and vagrants in the city.
Greetings from TNT. I am Tigress.
This is the original dance master.
This is Marsha Montana.
I'm Brother Valentino.
This is Marcia Miranda.
Caribbean Insight. Yes, I watch them all the time. They're bad.
Caribbean Insight. Really is dynamite. Caribbean Insight. Really super. Was spite. Caribbean Insight. Enjoy day or night. Caribbean Insight.
Welcome to another edition of Caribbean Insight. As you know, this is the show that keeps you in touch with the culture of the Caribbean. Tonight on this episode, we'll be chatting with a brother who started performing in the year 1972. And he has won the very first Young Kings competition in the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago in the year 1985. He continued working hard, bringing forward the political and social issues of the Republic. He won the Calypso Monarch in the year 1994. This brother's consistency, his standards, and his values have kept him out on the big stage over the years competing. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to be informed, educated, and entertained by a great writer, an educator, and Calypsonian, Mr. Morrell Peters, known in the Calypso arena as Luta. Luta, I want to welcome you to the show.
Wow, that's a big one. Thank you. Thank you very much, and it's nice to be here.
Okay, it's a pleasure to have you here. You started performing in 1972, but it wasn't until 85 that everyone got to know who was Luta when you won that Young King competition. And it was the very first time they had the show. What was it like for you?
Well, it was a great experience. I look back at those days as the glory days of Calypso. Mm-hmm. At that time, Calypso really reigned. And as a youngster in the business, you know, that was like the first major title that I had won at the time. Mm-hmm. And it so happened that it came in at the same time as the Calypso Monarch finals of that year. Mm-hmm. I also was like first runner up to Black Stallion, so that year was a big year and memorable one for me.
All right, Luta, you come from a religious background.
Yes, you may say so.
All right.
I've been sent to Sunday school. I grew up in the church, going to Sunday school and so on, and doing the good things.
And doing the good things.
Yes.
Okay. So how did you manage to enter upon the Calypso?
That's another good thing.
It's another good thing.
Yes. Okay.
But you know, at that time, being in the church, Calypso and the church, it was a kind of separation.
Yes.
So I'm kind of very curious to know how we came together.
I grew up with my aunt. Mm-hmm. And she was in the church and so on. And because of that, I was in church with her. And she thought that the Calypso business was a thing of the world, and therefore I should not be involved in that kind of activities.
Right.
So I kept my cool. I had liked Calypso from very early in life, in school days. I never took part in any school Calypso competition because I didn't have any in school. But I would always be singing Calypsos during school, in the school time, you know, and on the school desk, playing with friends, develop a rhythm, and Calypso was always there. Mm-hmm. And I would be searching the two radio stations we had at the time. I would be switching back and forth on both of them, trying to find where I could get a Calypso. I wanted to hear Calypso all the time. Mm-hmm. And my aunt noticed that and found that I was too much in love with this thing. Mm-hmm. And this wasn't, she didn't want me to go that way.
Okay.
So I kept my cool because I also learned then that I wouldn't be a man until I'm 21. So I actually started writing Calypso when I was about 17 years old, writing for other people and friends, you know,
okay,
in the area, you know, community, stuff like that, small things. And I kept my cool until I was 21. When I was 21, I was very much a man. Huh? And I decided, okay, this is my day. 21 also, I'm gone.
Okay.
And I started in 1972, when I was still 21, not yet 22.
Okay. But you explained to me that 1973 was a winning year for you in an unusual way.
Yes, yes, indeed it was. Because in 1973, I came to town for the first time, Calypso business, because in 72, I did a stint with a little tent in Point Front area called the St. Patrick Brigade. Mm-hmm. Run by a man who turned out to be a very good friend of mine, a guy called Theophilus Nathaniel. He ran that tent there. And in 73, I came to town and got into the bigger tent. That was the Calypso Theater at the time. And during the performances of that year, the television station, the one television station we had at the time, TTT, came by and looked at the show, and they chose six people from the tent mm-hmm. to appear on a special TTT program highlighting the tent. And I was one of those chosen. But the administrators of the tent at the time thought that, no, I just come from South, you know, country
yeah,
boy.
South boy, yeah, country boy.
Country boy, now okay. coming town. You know, so that kind of thing played off, and they told me, you know, I will go another time. And that other time never came. So the season ended, and I didn't go. And I decided, okay, since I was denied that opportunity to be on TTT, which was a big thing at the time, black and white as it was.
Of course.
Big. I decided, okay, I'm going to show you something, because I was always that type of person. To prove a point. I believe in that philosophy. So I take everything in stride and move on.
All right. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, on that note, let's go to the archives and be entertained and educated by Luta out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago.
Criminals on the street, they arm to the teeth. Innocent people are being shot everywhere. Oh, what a struggle. Living under constant fear. So I'm appealing to those in authority to give me a license, firearm to protect myself legally. And it's toy, gun for gun. Toy, toy, they bump to run. Toy, when the shot fall. Toy, toy, they bump to fall. I want to protect my property, myself and my family. Doi doi, they bump the run. Doi, when the shot call. Doi doi, they bump the ball. I am humble and poor, and I don't break the law. Walk my hands to the bone for everything that I own. Now behind my own fence, I live in under threat, no self-defense. Every day I'm facing death, and I'm not so lucky to get police protection. That is why I want the authorities to give me a firearm. And it's toy, gun for gun. Toy, toy, they bump to run. Toy, when they shot fall. Toy, toy, they bump. I don't want to die like watch with water at the hands of a vicious murder. Doi, gun for gun. Doi, doi, they bump to run. Doi, when they shot call. Doi, doi, they bump to fall. A concrete hook, burglar proof, Tuberman in my yard, plus security guard. I had to install electronic burglar alarm. Mama filled up with wall, and still I am free from harm. And if you're passing and you see what a bandit do, you better run inside, find a place to hide, cause they're killing the witness.
I want to protect my property, myself and my family. Doi, gun for gun, doi, doi, they bump the gun. Doi, when they shock call, doi, doi, they bump the call.
Ladies and gentlemen, remember you're watching the number one Caribbean show here in the USA today. So don't be caught home alone. Pick up the phone, call your friends, call your neighbors, and let them know that tonight we're chatting with Luta, one of the greatest Calypsonians out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago.
Do you know who I am? I am Ras Shorty Eye. I am a scientist, a musical scientist. I invented soca so that Caribbean people could have something to identify with wherever they go, any part of the world. Listen, you are viewing Caribbean Insight. Whenever I'm in New York City, I watch Caribbean Insight.
We're back here on Caribbean Insight and we're continuing to chat with Luta, one of the dynamic composers, writers, and Calypsonians out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. After 1973, which was considered one of your winning years, where you won all around, you ended up in Sparrow's Young Brigade in 77. Between that time, what was going on with Luta?
Well, I enjoyed my trip to New York in having won in 73, 74, 75. And I returned to Trinidad in 76 to join the Shorty's professional calypso tent.
Ras Shorty, you're talking about?
Yes, yeah. That tent was led by Ras Shorty and Kevin Pope, Duke, King Wellington. Those were the top guys in the tent then. And I joined that tent, and we only lasted 1 year. And the following year, 77, I went to Sparrow.
What was it like? As a young guy, a young Calypsonian, moving from the smaller tents to right into the Young Brigade with Sparrow?
Well, it's like, it's growth, you know, it's all about growth. It's about climbing and doing different things and growing. I'm always about that. My whole career has been like that, trying to do something different, trying to move up, you know, all the time. So this was another challenge to me. Sparrow, Calypso King of the World, you know, and this is bright lights, because when I was performing in the other tents, I would go down there and see, you know, look at performances. I always do. Till now, I always go and look at the other guys perform, because I always learn something. I always go to try to see if I would learn something. And having the opportunity to perform there, to me, was a great one. I enjoyed it tremendously. I went there, saw it as a challenge, and I went and took it up and went with it. It fit in beautifully. As a matter of fact, that year, 1977, was my first semifinals, first trip to the semifinals.
First trip to the semifinals.
Yeah, that was my first year at Sparrow, so they were very pleased with me. The manager then, Mr. Sil Taylor, we entered into a contract. He hadn't known anything about me at the time. New on the scene, just 1 year before, and so on, and then off the scene and then back inside. So I wasn't really known, and he entered into a contract with me, and after the first week performance, he doubled my earnings without negotiating.
I guess it had to be worth it.
Yeah, without negotiating, the performance did it for me.
Okay.
You know, and I was really grateful for that.
All right. Right after there, you moved on to the Masters then.
Yes, after 7, 8, 9 years, I think it was at Sparrow, 7, 8 years, yeah.
You spent 8 years with Sparrow.
Yeah, and then moved on to Masters then. Masters then had, at the time, was always an attraction, because there was this camaraderie and brotherhood in the Masters then that did not exist in the other tents.
With some of the brothers, some of the Calypsonians who were around at that time, yeah, in Masters.
Well, Shadow, of course.
Right.
We had Concobin, Coco, Gypsy, Cardinal, Ember, Height, Designer. Who am I forgetting? I mean, a good bunch of people. And we were all together. As far as I'm concerned,
right.
Masters then was the best thing that had ever happened to Calypso Tent Business.
Why do you say that?
It was beautiful. There was love, there was togetherness, you know, warmth. I mean, other Calypsonians used to leave other tents and hang out by the masters then because of that. Mm-hmm. We were just together. Nice. It was a great feeling.
The brotherhood, the camaraderie, that feeling of support that you explained was the best thing to ever happen in Calypso Tents. That took you to the big stage in 85.
Yes.
85 at Masters then. You won the Calypso Monarch, am I right?
No.
Okay.
85, I won the Young Kings.
Young Kings?
Young Kings 85.
Okay.
And that was the very first Young Kings competition.
Okay,
and
good.
I won that one.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in the finals for the first time. Calypso Monarch finals for the first time. And I played second to Black Stallion singing Dorothy.
In 85?
In 85, yeah.
Okay.
Wait, Dorothy, wait. It was a beautiful year for Calypso.
Uh-huh.
Really great, yeah. Really, really nice.
Why you say that?
Because I think Merchant was in singing Pal in Danger, Stallion was there with Dorothy, I was on his heels, and a beautiful year for Calypso. Yeah, it was really, really nice. The 80s generally was great for Calypso.
The 80s?
Yeah, the 80s, yeah.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, on that note, let's revisit the 80s and understand what Luta is talking about, that it was a beautiful year for Calypso.
In the beginning, when the master created man, he put him in a garden and gave him dominion. Oh yeah! And then he made him a woman and his loneliness. Man and his mate were in harmony and bliss.
Harmony and bliss.
Man's supposed to lead, but instead he allowed himself to be led, contrary to the master's plan. And then he blamed the woman as a shame. Shame, shame on you. You feel you is a macho man, but you are a manipu. Your ego swell up your chest, but you don't know you is a fool. I say shame, shame, shame on you. Man continue to shun his responsibility, creating free children and vagrants in the city. Society upside down, children out of control, the father's not around. Little one, hey little one, and the women say you're turning them off. You're girly girly and your hands so soft. You're always giving them a happy talk, hey man. You don't complete your work, I say shame, shame, shame on you. You feel you is a macho man, a manipu.
A manipu.
Your ego spell up your chest, but you don't know you is who. I say shame, shame. And that's why Patwa want,
I walk a man.
Denise want,
I walk a man.
Marcia want,
I walk a man.
All the girl them want,
I walk a man.
And I say shame, 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 shame. Uptown girl want,
I walk a man.
Downtown girl want,
I walk a man.
The midtown girl want,
I walk a man.
All the girl them want,
I walk a man.
And it's a shame, 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 shame. Shame on you. I love it. I'm tired with the rape and incest in society. I'm tired with violence. Teenage pregnancy. Good Lord, save the
children.
Oh,
save the children.
Young man, too many of your youthful years are spent behind prison bars. nighttime come. Shame, shame, shame on you. You feel you is a macho man, but you are a manicoo.
A manicoo.
Your ego swell up your chest, but you don't know you is cool. I said shame, shame, shame on you. Man as naked man, by the spot of thy bow thou shalt it burn. Not by a knife or a gun in your hand. And you who calling yourself harder, but all your contribute was the sperm. You'll never take time to ponder who's taking care of the home. It's only slam, bam, hit and run from responsibility. So you are a rascal, vagabond, monster, scum and menace to society. As a shame on you. Shame on you. Big, 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 big shame on you. Hey man. Shame on you. Delinquent fathers.
Shame on you.
Delinquent men.
Shame on you.
Delinquent fathers.
Shame on you.
Delinquent men.
Shame on you.
Delinquent fathers.
Shame on you.
Delinquent men.
Shame on you.
Delinquent fathers.
Shame on you.
And delinquent men.
Shame on you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're continuing to be entertained here on Caribbean Inside by Mr. Moral Peters, known as Luta in the Calypso Arena. But don't touch that dial. I'll be right back with much more.
This is Sunel Dempster, and whenever I'm in town, I watch no other but Caribbean Inside.
We're back here on Caribbean Inside, and we are continuing to chat with Luta, one of the dynamic Calypsonians out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Luta, your career continued. You have been consistent over the years. You have kept up, kept us informed. We here in New York, we depend on guys like you to keep us informed on what's going on with the politics in Trinidad and Tobago. And you have done a great job of that.
Well, thank you very much. I think I will continue.
And your career is based on certain principles and standards. You're a man who believe that your calypsos should also profile this.
I like artistry. Okay. I'm an artistic person.
Okay.
Whatever I do, I like fine touch, clean cut. You know, I'm like that. Things I do. People who know me, when know my work, you see my work, you will see. If I'm cutting grass, you will see, I sure look to cut that.
You're a perfectionist?
To some extent, yes.
To some extent, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I go the extra mile, you know, and sometimes unnecessarily so, but I feel that way. I like to have it right,
okay.
Perfect.
Okay.
You know, I try at all times to get that. I'm never satisfied with the recording. I'm never satisfied with it. I would feel that something else could have happened. You know, I needed something else there. I've settled for less all the time. Mm-hmm. I never had a recording that I am completely satisfied with.
Even the one you won with in 94?
Well, the composition, you know, I'm satisfied with that. I look at it and hear. Yeah, I'm satisfied with the composition. I'm talking about the recording. When you go to the studio to do a studio recording, it's always seen something, always seems to be missing.
Okay.
You know, okay. But I like to work. You know, I like to work. Sometimes a lot of guys come to me with stuff, you know, to finish it off because they feel that when I put a touch to it, something else will happen. And I hate and I marvel at how it has complete like that. I've seen other things to do. But they find like they don't like to work so hard.
They don't like to go that extra mile.
I love it. And I use sometimes that shorty eye, watch what my children to explain going the extra mile. At the end of his verses in the song, he said, I give you my counsel because I don't want to see you go up and so on. And then he ends the verse by saying, an extra line. I don't remember the line right now, but there's an extra line that wasn't really necessary, but he does it anyway.
Because the message was already given, but he put the icing on the cake.
Yes, that is going the extra mile, and this is always good.
Artistry in Calypso, in the year 1994, when you won the crown with the driver driving smoke.
Good.
And the country
good,
movie.
Good, good driving.
Good driving.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What was that song all about?
Well, there's a little bit of history.
Okay.
Prior to 94, I've been doing, exceedingly good work.
Okay.
And I believe that it is because of political bias.
Mm-hmm.
I've been left out.
Okay.
And even on that occasion when I won, I was left out.
Why you say
in 94,
that?
I was left out. I came in because I was able to fight and show that I was left out wrongfully. Well, over the years, they've been choosing like 10 semi-finalists from the semi-finals into the finals.
Mm-hmm.
And on this particular occasion, they chose 9.
Just like that.
They chose 9. And when I checked, I realized that I was number 10. So they chose 9 because I mustn't be there. And good enough to win. I mustn't be there. So I have every reason to believe that it was politically motivated. Because of the experiences before. I did a song in 1991 called Think Again. Great composition, beautiful song, but of course it was going against the grain, and again I was left out. Then I did Law and Justice, another piece that, another song called Just a Matter of Time. For Just a Matter of Time, I won the award for the best nation building song for that year.
Okay.
Yet I was not in the finals. I was not among the finalists.
Mm-hmm.
I took that and went on. And in 94, when they announced the finalists and I wasn't there, after good driving, I said, no man, something had to be wrong. So after checking and realized that I was 10th on the list, and we went to the NCC and questioned it. When was that decision taken to move from 10?
10 finalists to 9.
To 9.
Mm-hmm.
Who authorized it and what were the conditions and how the decision was taken? They made a release saying that I was included. Eventually, they couldn't answer that question and I was included.
So if you didn't question that?
I would have been out.
It would have been just...
I was already out.
They already excluded
you. Yeah, if I didn't question, I would stay out. So these are the type of things that go by and makes it ugly. Unfortunately, it worked for me. Because on the night of the competition, I had nothing to lose. I was already out. Alas, at number 10, I can't come anything less than last.
Uh-huh.
So I had no pressure at all on me. So I was laughing my way. And I was, in my mind, the attitude was, tell all these people who are viewing and looking at this and listening to this, tell them that this is not good enough to be here. That was the attitude that I'm singing with the night of the competition. Because I know that the material was good enough to be there. And I know that many other times before, I should have been there. And it is because of political bias I wasn't there. Okay. But it's all right.
So the driver driving smooth was really, what was that song about?
It is political satire. It is sarcasm at the highest. The driver I'm talking about in this song is the prime minister at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it is based on The Driver Can't Drive by Chalkness some years before, when there was another prime minister.
Okay.
So in come this new prime minister and doing a lot of stuff that I believe should be criticized. But nobody's saying anything.
Mm-hmm.
So I assume that the driver is driving good. That's why we're not hearing anything from the badge.
Mm-hmm.
The men who've been at the throat of the prime minister prior to that. We had, I don't want to go into the personalities, but we had Calypsonians attacking the prime minister mm-hmm. and so on, and that's all good.
Mm-hmm.
But when the prime minister changed, no more attacks, and there were things to attack.
Things to be said.
Yes.
Things to be brought to the forefront.
Of course.
Okay.
And I feel that the role of the Calypso is to continue to do that.
Yeah, no, but you can't take a side.
Can't
you
take sides.
Present and the facts.
So and I don't want to rock the boat, I don't want to interfere with anybody. So I took a safe line. Rather than go and criticize the people, prime minister, say, boy, the driver driving good.
Okay.
So let's not say anything bad about him. He's a good boy.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, on that note, let's revisit the year 1994 and listen to Luta with Good Driving.
They say he was too vindictive and wicked, and he had vengeance against Rene. And Abu Bakr should kill him, July 1990. He only thinking about Tobago, and he deserved to be alive. So we kick him out and tell him go, singing the driver can't drive. But now the driver's driving good.
The driver's driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
The driver renovated the kitchen for 1.6 million. Advertise the face on TV for only 400 grand. Boy, the driver's driving good.
The driver's driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
You better take your separation and don't call it retrenchment. That's right-sizing operation from the people's government. I tell you, the driver driving good.
Driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
The dragon spitting fire, look how them five little children drum. Explosion in Camp Omega, so the driver took the dragon down. But then 13 people dead in St. Anne's, up to now are still feeling shame. After thorough investigations, they can't even find a dove to blame. Boy, the driver's driving good.
Driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
I fell about $12 million with bad planning, he lost everything. But the driver take him and make him minister of planning. Boy, the driver driving good.
The driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
Eric William died since 81, and this everybody know. Yet the driver say he's just holding on, and it's Eric running the show. I tell you, the driver's driving good.
The driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
Stupid to oppose them. This is B&M country. Robinson was the problem. Praise God, we get rid of him. Since we sent him back to Cascara, poor people are poor again. No more armories and murder. No more vagrants in Port of Spain. That's because the driver's driving good.
The driver's driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
And there was no devaluation. The dollar just floating tongue. That's the way to fight inflation. This year, food price coming down. I tell you, the driver's driving good.
The driver's driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
You're paying too much tax already, and this is a caring government. So the exorbitant transfer fee is not a tax, that's a punishment. I tell you, the driver's driving good.
Driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country going.
Boom, 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 boom.
is stupid, because he explain yet why he think it is valid to put more Indians in cabinet. When it come to making budget, what an outstanding human being. Oil is $13 on the market, but he sure we go get 19. Why the driver driving good?
Driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
The driver went and tell Bill Clinton he want to catch some drug traffickers. But if he ain't get assistance, all are we go be drug pushers. Hey, the driver driving good.
The driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
They used to call Eric Deffy Robinson, they say was heartless. I and all thought Chambers done see, but this fella is the best. Boy, the driver driving good.
The driver driving.
The country moving smooth.
The country moving.
Well, TV family, whether you're out in Boston, the Bronx, Long Island, Queens, and you in Brooklyn here, you know I can't forget you guys. Tonight, you're being entertained by one of the best social and political commentators out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. And I'll be right back with much more.
My name is Winston Beery, better known as Shadow. Whenever I am in New York, I look at Caribbean.
Luta, the year 2001. Okay, you did a number, it was dedicated to the woman, Jamo Woman. Okay, you wrote that song.
Yes, I did.
Okay, what brought about this change? Because it wasn't a political commentary now. It was like, how should I say, praising the woman.
Oh, wait a woman. I don't only do political commentary.
But this is what we know most of the time. This is what we hear.
And I believe the radio station and they have to take responsibility for that.
Okay.
Because I produce a lot of music, and they just choose to highlight the political songs. But there are a lot of other things I do.
Okay.
Jamo Woman, this was a lot of things I do because I am really moved emotionally or touched or pained in some way.
Okay.
And I don't just do things.
Okay.
For fun, or right. The fun of it, I do it because I really mean you
what
know,
you're doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sometimes I do it to try to effect change or try to express a thought or something like that. But I always do something that I really believe in.
Okay.
And I felt compelled to do Jamo Woman because not only because of the contribution that Shorty made to music, but that too, but mostly because of the courage and strength displayed by his wife.
Okay.
During his illness, she was in an interview, and a question was put to her as to how do you cope with this, and you know, she seemed to be so relaxed in all this and so on. And her response to that was that in her life, she learned to hold on by letting go. And that to me was so philosophical and so deep. I was really moved by that statement. And when I put that together with what I know of her in the relationship with her husband, I said, hey, this woman is really, really, really strong. And I felt compelled to say something about the strength in this woman, say something that would reflect that, recognize that. And not only in that woman, but in the role that women play in the lives of men.
Okay.
A role that generally we tend to neglect or not recognize or acknowledge publicly and so on. And I said, I must do something about that. But I also wanted to do something about Rashorty I. I wanted to say something about him. That's two different songs. But I wanted to do one.
And cover.
I wanted to do one song to do both things.
Okay.
And I just couldn't find a way how to do it. I couldn't find a way at all. And I kept wanting to do that for about 3 weeks. And suddenly one night, it just dawned on me that this is the approach. And I took it from there. It was like, you know, it looked like a dream come true. Because I really wanted to do the song in that way. Mm-hmm. And for the performance on the Masquerade Night 2001, mm-hmm. I wanted silence. I wanted the mood to be exactly as it was.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I am concerned, that performance that night of that song was the greatest performance that I have done with any piece of work, because it came out exactly as I wanted it. I wanted this piece. I had a flute, Michelle playing a flute, a woman doing the flute in the song,
mm-hmm.
a single dancer on stage, and if a pin drop, you would hear. And that's exactly what I wanted. So as far as I am concerned, I was a winner.
You were a winner.
I was a winner, all the way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's go back to the stage that night, 2001, and see if you can hear a pin drop during this performance.
Garfield, black man, love man, Ras Shorty Eye. Boy, you touch every soul. Dance to the Most High, the Most High. But behind every successful man, there's a woman. And on this occasion, a woman of distinction, who weathered the storm through the canteen, took the good, the bad, the ugly, everything, loyal and devoted to you till death. How could we ever forget Claudette? Oh, what a woman she is. What a woman she is. Oh, what a woman she is. Oh, what a woman she is. Aye, aye. What a blessed woman she is. Aye, aye, hey.
Badam, badam.
Garfield, Garfield, black man, hey. Love man, Ras Shorty Eye.
I and I.
Endless vibrations from your sweet music, your strong admonition, we are grateful for it. Thanks to the Most High, the Most High. But behind every successful man,
a song dedicated to all the women of the world. But listen, don't touch that dial. Pick up the phone, call your friends, call your neighbors, because I'll be right back with much more.
Do you know who I am? I am Ras Shorty Eye. I am a scientist, a musical scientist. I invented soca so that Caribbean people could have something to identify with wherever they go, any part of the world. Listen, you are viewing Caribbean Insight. Whenever I'm in New York City, I watch Caribbean Insight.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, in my hand, I'm holding just two of the many CDs from the man Luta. We have the 25 years Silver Anniversary, Volume 1 and 2. Then we have African Drums. And what's the name of the CD with Jamu Woman?
That's Platinum Soca.
Platinum Soca. So you heard it. And remember, I always say to you, culture is a way of life. You gotta go out there and support it. Go out and check your record stores and distributors. Tell them you wanna get Luther's Silver Anniversary, where you can sit down and listen to the music at your own time. But you know, it's only 1 hour we have here to do it. Luther, I wanna thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for having me. It's been a great experience.
You're welcome. You're welcome. And anytime you come Lady to New York, come and fill us in on what's going on, man.
Lady VV in the middle of love.
Okay. All right. I'll take it there.
Okay.
All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, on that note, I'll see you next week. Same time, same place. God bless you all.
This is the land of Calypso. Mama, this is the land of jam. In Trinidad and Tobago, it's a blendy Calypsonia. Calypso is heavy jamming from a tree and pecan. So if you can't bounce and swing, you just don't belong. And if for some reason, Calypso making you blue, listen to me carefully, I have some advice for you. Society is reflected in Calypso, and you can't take me jamming. Pack up your thing and go. And if the Hindu man is a racist, and the Calypsonian says so, and you can't take me jamming. Pack up your thing and go. Pack your bag, back to Kaone. Pack your bag, you and your age. You could spy your thing with the media, but you can't muscle Calypso. And if you can't take the charming, pack up your thing and go. Pack your bag, hey man. Pack your bag and go. Mister, pack your bag and go. Calypsonians jam all of them. You was right there sitting and laughing. Calypso was no problem. But soon as you enter office, everything changed up. Calypsonians are not racist, wicked and corrupt. But I want to remind you, just in case you forget, it only now start this party care done. We now start offend. Nobody has send and call you. You jump in the thing just so. If you can't take it, jamming, pack up your thing and go. You have a problem with timing, and that everybody knows. But if you can't take it, jamming, pack up your thing and go. Pack your bag, back where you come from.
Pack your bag,
go and drink your rum. The girls could climb up your ladder from Cuba to San Fernando. But if you can't take it, jamming, pack up your thing and go.